हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, KTHM कॉलेज, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस, क्लास MA, MCOM, MSc, सेमिस्टर सेकेंड। मायसेल्फ वसुधा चंदनशिवे वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द सब्जेक्ट ह्यूमन वैल्यूज एंड ह्यूमन राइट्स फॉर एडिशनल क्रेडिट। सो स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट द सेकेंड चैप्टर, दैट इज ह्यूमन राइट्स and enforcement mechanisms. So students, we will go through it in detail. Okay? So students, the human rights and its enforcement mechanism. So first of all, we will go through the brief overview of human rights issue in our India. So In this second unit, it introduces the ways and means how to achieve the guaranteed rights in the constitution. It will also introduce the remedial care mechanism available for the breach of the respective rights guaranteed by the constitution and legislature in a subtle perspective. So now it also describes this unit describes in which the various authorities and judiciaries in India function in argument the rights guaranteed to people under constitution and national international laws and various policies. So students, the brief overview of human rights is that from ancient to the modern times, the philosophy perspective of India emphasizes on the implementation and realization of human rights through duties. So all the texts of ancient and medieval times, from them that the constitution of India, a number of legislative enactments and extensively discuss the significance and promotion of human rights. So however, due to the vastness of the country, high population, poverty, the impact of distributions of land introduced by the British government between various committees, illiteracy, malnutrition, and many other issues that had their own impact on the realization of rights guaranteed by the constitution by millions of the citizenry of the polity. So being a party to a United Nation, a number of document on human rights from promise to fulfill the ideals of international law through constitutional means. So the government of India in year 1993 enacted the Human Rights Act. So the enactment of the act fulfilled to affirm the rights of citizens and constituted a national human rights commission to discharge its commitment as a party to the principle of Paris 1991 on. So on the constitution of structure, power and functioning of a national human rights commission. So students, after that we are going to learn about the National Human Rights Act 1993. So India, being a party to a number of international legal documents on human rights and to give efforts to the Article 51C of our Indian Constitution, it enact that the Human Rights Act in 1993. Please keep in mind the date of this act, National Human Rights Act 1993. It's very important from the perspective of exam. So to extend a speedy protection mechanism for the promotions and protection of human rights, the objective of act is to establish a commission of human rights both at the national union and at the state level. It also proposed to establish human rights courts at the district level in order to address the issues of human rights that need to be redressed at quick span. So in 2006, the act was amended and brought in a number of provisions for effective functioning of the commission. Since the implementation of act, so the government of India and the state in the country established commission of human rights. So though the constitution of India clearly demarcate that fundamental rights, directive principle of state policy, fundamental duties for the first time at all This have been defined as human rights in the Act in tune with the policy of international law of human rights. So according to Section 2D of the Act, human rights means right of an individual relating to life, liberty, equality, dignity guaranteed to an individual by constitution and by international covenants that have a binding nature on the state and its various organs. So even before the Act came into existence, interpreting the numerous provisions of the Constitution, a number of cases, the judiciary through the concept of public interest, legislations promoted the concept of human rights. So this is about the National Human Rights Act 1993. After that, we are going to learn about the judicial organs. So judicial organs, it is a hallmark of democracy that the judicial organs need to be independent. The judiciary is an important and vital organ to promote not only the principle of democracy and the rule of law, but also it ensures that human rights are protected in true spirit and philosophy with which they are advocated. So, this philosophy, the Constitution has advocated for the establishment of independent judicial organ to stand between the citizens and state to prevent the excess use of power by executive legislature. So at the same time, as per the provision to the Constitution, especially directive principle of state policy, there is an inherent obligations on the state to take affirmative action in many areas to cherish the fundamental rights. If the state fails to discharge its obligation, the judiciary is not only natural organ which can compel a state to take positive action in order to make the right effects. So the Constitution of India advocated that the creation of Supreme Court as the highest court of the judicial system. Further, considering the federal features of the union of the state, every state has been advocated to have a high court as the highest court of each state. So Supreme Court is for the all India, but after that the high courts at the district level should be there. So this being the courts advocated by the Constitution, they are also referred to as constitutional courts. So the other courts within the state may be created by a statutes. Okay, this is all about judicial organ. So now in that judicial organ, there is Supreme Court as well as there is also High Courts. So we will go through Supreme Court in short and High Court also. So the Supreme Court of India. The Supreme Court of India, being an apex court of country, is located in New Delhi. So being the highest court of the country, its decisions are binding on a legal organ and people. It has originally appellate and consultative jurisdictions. So being a highest court, it has a number of inherent powers to exercise to uphold principle of rule of law and the provisions of the Constitution. So in the originally jurisdiction, it exercised power under Article 32 of the Constitution to protect the rights of the citizens guaranteed under the Constitution, and we know that Article 32, what is Article 32? Constitutional remedies. So students, when we got the ill treatment, means there is a force on our fundamental rights, we directly appeal to the High Court. We know that five rights, habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibitions. No, we know that writs. So, according to the Article 32 of the Constitution, the protection of rights of the citizen guaranteed under the Constitution, under the Article 31, it exercises jurisdiction in case if there is arise or dispute between a union and a state or between states apart from other jurisdiction to entertain case of civil and criminal nature. So according to the Article 32 of the Constitution, it has power to issue writs, directions or orders to an authority for the enforcement of fundamental rights. The right to move, Supreme Court being a fundamental right, it cannot be suspended except otherwise provided by the Constitution. So, this is all about, means we are going in a short with the Supreme Court. It's very big. There are many cases, many legislations. Okay, students, but we are going in short. So, after that, there is High Courts. So, the system of courts at the level of states is not a new concept of India. It's not new to the India. Even before the Constitution of India came in existence, three high courts in Mumbai, Calcutta and Madras was established in 1862. We know that the three high courts were in Mumbai, Madras and Calcutta in 1862. So the power and function of there were defined by legislation from time to time. The Constituent Assembly considering the significance of high courts provide the establishment of more high courts in the various states. So accordingly, Article 214 to 235 of the Constitution deals with the various aspects of the right of the high courts. So according to the provisions of Constitution, normally there will be high courts for each state. However, the Parliament of India by laws has the power to extend the jurisdiction of the high courts to more than one state. So accordingly, there are 21 high courts are present in our and are functioning in our country. How many? 21 high courts. So high courts are the highest judicial authority of the states. They have judicial and administrative power as well. So the administrative provinces of high courts extend to all the lower courts and tribunals working in state or jurisdictions conferred by the law. So decision given by high court may be challenged before the Supreme Court of India according to the provision prescribed for such appeal on the lines of Supreme Court. So the high courts being constitutional court have a number of powers to protect the right of the citizen. So according to the Article 226, the high courts are empowered to issue writs of various kinds to protect the rights of affected people. So the provision of Article 226 have been amended a number of times to being in clarity to exercise the powers based on the judgments of the Supreme Court of the India. So we will say that briefly, when we briefly examine the powers of Supreme Court and High Courts, so it makes clear significant role played by judiciary in the promotion protection of constitutional rights that are guaranteed to various organs and the citizens. So the provision of 32 and 226 conferred the powers on judiciary not only to argue the rights guaranteed under the Constitution, but also the inject the philosophical framework of the international law of human rights. So the power conferred under this article to judiciary organ is described as a judicial review in the realm of the philosophy law. Okay, students. So this is all about the brief overview of human rights issue in India. After that, we have learned about the National Human Rights Act 1993. After that, judicial organ, which is Supreme Court and the High Court. Okay, students. So students, we have done with second unit, the first part. We are in next lecture we are going to see various commission of the national level and also at the state level, means at the Maharashtra level. So students, till now we have learned that, please try to understand. Okay, thank you.